In the last 10 years, our commitment to stability has been tested again and again. In the Asian crisis in 1997-8, the Russian crisis, the American recession, the trebling of oil prices. And of course, in the last month, with a wake-up call for every financial system around the world, a wave of turbulence that started in America, then Germany, has impacted on all countries and tested the stability of our own system. I believe it's because of the resilience of the system that has been built in the United Kingdom, Bank of England independence, the Financial Services Authority, the tripartite system we now have, that we are able to steer a stable course. I think the main thesis of the book, Age of Turbulence, which I'm now advertising to all people here, Alan, is that turbulence that is the essence of the new financial system. But what we see now is a greater flexibility, a greater ability to be able to respond to events. And this, I think, has already proven to be true. In any other decade but ours, a trebling of world oil prices might have caused a recession, but I believe the world economy showed itself flexible enough to adjust. Double-digit prices in price rises in housing in the United Kingdom in other decades have sparked downturns, but we have been flexible enough to be able to adapt. And I believe that because of the changes that have been made worldwide and then the changes that we've made in Britain, we are sufficiently flexible to adjust when events threaten our growth. And we will certainly continue to take all measures that are necessary to ensure that we are in future even more flexible to deal with events as they arise and to steer a course of stability. So we will take no risks with the economy. There'll be no irresponsible relaxation of pay discipline in the public sector, no unfunded spending commitments, no unaffordable promises, no short-term giveaways, and responsible government demands that stability will be our determination first and foremost yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Now today, thanks to the dynamism and enterprise and public-spiritedness of business leaders and workforces represented here today, Britain, this small island with its small number of people, is the fifth largest economy in the world. And as things move quickly in a changing global economy, so too the policies we pursue will show that we will change, we will adapt, we will be flexible, and we will raise our game. Winston Churchill once warned of countries facing change that was so timid that they were, in his words, resolved to be irresolute, adamant for drift, solid for fluidity, and all-powerful for impotence. And he also said that instead of building the present upon the image of the past, we must face directly up to all the challenges of the future. And I believe that as we move to the next stage of our journey, we share the vision of British business and commerce, of a Britain that can lead the global economy. It's because of the strength of the British economy that, notwithstanding the primary responsibility of those who own and run banks to prevent problems happening in their own institutions, we were able to guarantee the savers at Northern Rock and at the same time to continue to steer a path of low inflation, low interest rates and continued growth. In the days ahead, we'll continue to respond with the same calm vigilance. It's time, however, to recognize that there are changes in the financial system globally as well as nationally that do need to be made. Of course, some of the wisdom we need is to refuse, even in the wake of difficulties, to make unnecessary changes. When Enron and WorldCom happened, we did not in Britain respond with heavy-handed regulation. I believe that was the right decision then, and in the same way, we will not make that mistake now. But we will take measures that are necessary. I want, at a global level, as I've always believed it should be, the Financial Stability Forum to become a better early warning system about risks in the international community. I want progress internationally on rules governing liquidity, solvency, regulation, and off-balance sheet investments. Alistair Darling has been working on and will announce the legal changes he wishes to introduce on reform of savers' compensation, and he will press for the changes that are necessary in European rules. But our underlying purpose is to make Britain global leaders in all those services and manufacturing sectors whereby our skills, our creativity, our enterprise, and particularly our flexibility, and backed up, of course, by investment in infrastructure, we can be world class. At every point, we should ask of ourselves, how can we be first, achieve excellence, and lead the world? I believe that we can be a world leader in the science of the future, but to do that, we must invest. Universities, research institutes, knowledge centers linked up to business, companies challenged across new frontiers in innovation. And later this week, in response to a review by Lord Sainsbury, we will be announcing measures to help Britain become one of the world's leading high-tech economies. We will set out new plans to make Britain a world leader in medical research and enable the NHS to benefit from innovation in the search for cures and vaccines of tomorrow. I believe we can be a world leader in energy and environmental technologies, from renewables to carbon capture, including nuclear. And we must not only step up our efforts in research and development, but also ensure that there are more positive incentives for commercial deployment. We are launching our new £650 million Energy Technologies Institute, and that will be for Britain a unique public-private partnership, which I hope will be replicated in every continent of the world, to pioneer new engineering solutions at the same time as we seek to build a global carbon market from here in London. I believe that to be a world leader in the creative industries, we must and will encourage a renaissance in British design and creativity in our schools, our colleges, and our universities, backed up by a network of innovation centres in every region of the country. In modern manufacturing, we will provide the best incentives for research and development, and of course, we will continue to focus on competitiveness in Europe, resuscitating the Lisbon agenda for reform, urgent progress that we wish to see in the world trade talks that will benefit Europe and the rest of the world. And I believe that liberalizing trade is the only way to secure prosperity in the global economy. You know better than me how we are and can continue to entrench our position as a world leader in business and financial services. But from the point of view of the government, we insist that we will continue to implement our new risk-based, light-touch approach to regulation. We will make our planning system more flexible and responsive. And of course, we will work together on infrastructure to invest in our long-term priorities. And I believe that that is an important part of London retaining its position as the preeminent financial centre in so many sectors. For decades, the idea of Crossrail, a major new railway link between East and West London, has been a dream for business and Londoners alike. Connecting central London, the city, Canary Wharf, to Heathrow and to commuter areas east and west of the capital. We've already committed £400 million simply to detail design for the project to give us the best possible basis for making a decision. Work independently tested has established that the appropriate budget for the project is £16 billion, a start for main construction in 2010, and trains beginning to run from the middle of the decade, the next decade. No government has previously managed to bring the necessary finance together. In the last few months, we've worked night and day to achieve this. A comprehensive package is now needed to fund the £16 billion required, largely from the public sector, but also including the proceeds from a business rate and additional contribution from certain London businesses and developers who would benefit significantly from Crossrail. I want the project to go ahead immediately, subject to the satisfactory conclusion of detailed negotiations for additional contributions from all beneficiaries, and the City of London will need to make a significant contribution. This is a huge national project, vital for long-term prosperity of our capital city, and indeed vital to the whole country. And if others are prepared to play the part, the necessary funding from the government will be provided in our spending review, funding only possible because we've kept spending under control in other areas. Dr. Greenspan says in his new book, "We're living in a new world, the world of a global capitalist economy that is vastly more flexible, resilient, open, self-correcting, and fast-changing than it was even a quarter of a century earlier. It's a world," he says, "that presents us with huge possibilities, but also new challenges." But he concludes, as I want to conclude, that we are deeply optimistic about the future, perhaps more optimistic than ever about what we can do working together.